So I'm always look on the hunt for how to make my static analysis stricter. And in 4.1, there is a new option which gives me the opportunity to make things even more strict, but it's quite a challenging rule. So let me show you. So let me start and write an array. So let's say 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. So far, so good. And then I can do B equals A at index 0, right? Maybe do. So what is the type of B?
So the type of B should be number, I guess.
Yes, perfect. Oh, let me just disable ESLint.
Yes, first talk about how strict everything is, then disable it.
Can I actually?
And I think it's like ESLint disable. But then I have
a rule to disable ESLint disable. So it's getting pretty.
Oh, but now you can use a quick fix and ignore.
That's perfect.
Wow.
Okay. And yeah, speaking of making everything strict, here we are. No, because I only want to show TypeScript things. So you write B is of type number. So now there is a new option to check the indexes of A. And that option is called no unchecked indexed access.
Wow.
So now if I set it to true, what's the type of B?
Is it one?
What? that's a good point, actually. It's not one.
I've heard something like this is also like possible if you use like the as const keyword.
Yes.
But okay, it's still number, I guess.
So A is not of type 1, 2, 3, 4, 5.
Oh, no.
It's of type number, array number.
Oh, I figured it out. So B now it's number or undefined.
Exactly.
Because maybe it could be an empty array.
Yes.
Wow.
So now, like you said, we can make it a tuple. So right now it's typed as array of number. So we make it a tuple. And so now it's typed as a immutable 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. So now B is of type 1. And of course, The advantage of this rule is that if I do 10, now I get an error because 10 is not a key of A.
Wow, that is so nice.
That's super nice. The problem is that, if you apply it to existing huge code bases, it relies, so all the map, filter, reduce, they don't know about tuple. And so we make a lot of inferences about the code we're writing, which suddenly the compiler is not catching. So let me show you a couple of examples. So first of all, here, if I remove the as const, and so B is of type undefined, but you know that B, like for instance, if I do 1, you know that B shouldn't be undefined. So one way you can use the null assertion operator. So this asserts that B is of type number. So that's how you could, if you have this rule enabled and you want to try some legacy code to work, that's how you could make it work. I find it to be pretty dirty. But so if we go back to a tuple now. But that's basically on the 4.1 announcement, that's the technique. They say, okay, if you want to make your code work, you can use a null type assertion. So now if we do A map, so the problem is that the whole array infrastructure doesn't know about tuple. So if you do map of element index, and I do B equals, let's say, E at index. Of course, here you have the element, but let's say I have B, right? I have another array. Sometimes we match, right, arrays together. So I do C equals B at I. So what's the type of C?
I would hope that it's 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. One or
type
two
of C? Ah, yeah, yeah. So
or
it can
undefined.
Even though
makes
here, it makes sense because I is of type number. and it's not of type key, right? It should be of type 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, keys of B, right? So here if I do, I want to type, so here it's not going to work anyways. So even if I overload the type, it's not going to work because on the standard function, it's typed as number and not typed as key of the tuple. So this one actually is typed properly, which is great.
I see. So if the index could be between 0 and 4,
yes,
then TypeScript would have enough information to assure that whatever C is not undefined.
Yes. So I love this stuff. And by the way, so there is a whole, and I haven't digged into it yet, but there is a lot of community. There is a community that loves digging into these advanced. And this is nothing for them. It's like not even advanced TypeScript. But then you see that people, they go pretty far on, you know, experimenting with how far you can go with the type system. But so I was thinking, let's say I have my own map implementation and now I can specify the type of I to not be number. So first I was like, intuitively, what would you write for I?
0 or 1 or 2 or 3 or 4?
Yes, but how do you get this value automatically? Because, you know, for any... Intuitively, I don't know about you, but I wrote key of type of A or type of B, for instance.
I see. Yeah, you can do that.
But here we get all these... You see these... And here we get number, so it's...
That's kind of messed up. Yes. And then it's like, it's not even... It's like a string.
Yes.
A string of one.
Yes.
It's kind of strange.
Yeah, very strange. I mean, which is correct, right? Because here you can access the indexes through the string representation,
yeah,
right?
Yeah, right.
So I wrote... So here I don't think it's useful, but that was a lot of fun to do. And here I have to give a big shout out to... Pierre-Antoine Mills, who taught me this technique and is writing really great articles about advanced TypeScript patterns. We will link to it in the video description. But so, based on his help, I was able to write. So we want to write a generic code. But honestly, that might not even be the best practice, but that was a lot of fun to write. So index of, type of. So we can create index of. So do you know how to we would define a type that?
No, this is something that I'm not good enough. I know there was like a TypeScript puzzle site. And it's like, like 120 exercises to improve your TypeScript skills and how you write types. And I was like doing number one and I had no idea.
Exactly. So but I love it. So yes, you're gonna love this one. So we get a type here, right? Which extends some sort of tuple.
Okay, makes sense.
So the way you get all the keys, I love it. We're going to use recursive types. And so if you have something recursive, you need to stop condition, right? So we're going to add the... So this is the type parameter. And the second generic is going to be the state of our recursive type, which we're going to pass along. And the stop condition, so we're going to increase an array in size. And once the size of the array, so that's our state, reaches the same size of the input tuple, we're going to stop and return the result. And so here we're going to store a state. And so this default value is an empty array. So what we want to do is to increase for each iteration or each recursive call, we want to increase the state by one. And when the array size has reached the size of t, we return the result. So actually, let's start with the stop condition. So we can do t length.
Wow.
Length stands, that's pretty cool. state length. Let me just make it. Oops. Um, here we return the result. So we return S, the state. And if not, we do a recursive call. So we pass T as parameter, and then we increase the array of size of by one. So we pass.
Oh, so you can just do plus one in TypeScript?
Yes. So here I want 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. So you can count in TypeScript like this.
Wow.
And how do you count? How do I get 0, 1, 2? By doing state length. Because at the beginning it's going to be 0. In the next index of recursive call, it's going to be 1 and so on. So index length. And you pass the rest of the array like this. Did I misspell length? Or how do I need to do extends? Here it's going to be numbers. So now index of type A. So here we have an array, right? So it returns an array of all indexes, 0, 1, 2, 3, 4. We want the union type, right? So I do here, select all numbers of all the that are types number. And here we get the proper type for index.
No way.
And so C now is indexed properly. It's not undefined anymore.
Wow, that's insane.
I'm not saying that's the best practice for doing this, but that's a lot of fun to build these. Like,
so if you would now say like C equals B, one, I plus one, then it would once again recognize that it could become undefined. No way.
But here you could almost argue. Yeah, no, it's that's correct. Because it could be 6, it could be 5. So therefore it's...
Wow, that's so crazy. I had no idea you could do this with TypeScript.
And I want to investigate this further. Because like you said, people are writing these crazy puzzles. I feel like I'm only scratching the surface with it. And this is a hell of fun. So I want to go deeper with this. And another advanced... type feature I got to play with last week is type string literals, which we talked about a couple of weeks ago. So in this week's video, we build a chess game. And so you have the chess board notation, H2, A3, and so on. And then we move the pieces along the board. So we have translation, like, you know, X, Y. And so we want to be able to go from X, Y values to chess notation. And so here you can do crazy things like, I mean, you can type all chess notations in types, even like the pieces and so on, and have everything strictly typed. Because you could do row type. Type row is, let's say, A or B. Type call is, let's say, 1 or 2. And so then you can do a function, let's say 2 position, and you get, you get, let's say, position, and you can type it as, you don't have the backtick on the Swiss keyboard. Oh, no. How do you do a backtick? Oh, no, okay. You have it, actually. So let me switch to the Swiss key.
Yes, it's like shift and like
question mark. Oh, no, you have the backtick, sorry.
Yeah, but then it's like, it's weird.
So let me switch back to American. It does like
3 backticks if you press backtick.
And now you can do row. So it's a concatenation of row and column. And now position is all the possible combinations.
Wow, so nice.
It's pretty cool.
And yeah, it makes so much sense because the chessboard has 64 fields.
Yes.
So, I mean... Of course, also, you're a noob if you write A1, A2, A3, A4. Yes. So this is super knowledgeable.
Yeah, and you have like, even also with the pieces, instead of writing, you know, black pawn, black, you have like color piece, type piece, and then you... And again, here, I think it's only barely scratching the surface. So pretty exciting stuff. Also, I think, I don't know what you feel like, but I think that it gives us a vision of where TypeScript is going into the future. Because I feel like now the tuple support needs to go way further. So things like what we just tried to write, index of tuple, this should be built in, right? Support for tuple in map, filter, reduce in the standard library, I guess, should or maybe I'm misunderstanding the issue, but I feel like now that's where it needs to go forward. I don't know, but pretty exciting.
Absolutely, and I feel like this type system that you've just demonstrated, or like the capabilities of it, are like so superior to other programming languages. If I thought about the types in Go, for example, it's such a pain. They don't even have generics, and it's really not you reach the end of the capabilities so soon. But TypeScript, wow, it's like it's a monster.
To your point, I was always, you know, I always go back to the beginning of TypeScript where people were telling me, but because you have so much baggage and you have to type the untyped world of JavaScript, you will never be as good as typed languages. And at the time, I was like, oh, yeah, you're right. Actually, that's a huge challenge. And now to see that exactly, like you said, they became better than a lot of professional type systems, is like, whoa. I don't know. Crazy stuff. And here, this is only scratching the surface. I mean, we see stuff online that are much crazier advanced TypeScript patterns. And maybe next week I show you a new one.
I'm super excited.
Cool.
I mean, it just reminded me that TypeScript, it's not just like JavaScript of types. It's so much more. I'm
still eating some, but again, here it might be because I'm a beginner with advanced TypeScript. I'm eating some use cases which I cannot do with these advanced type patterns. You know, I do interpolate path in Redash. So here you pass the input range, the output range. So you know that these tuples are equal, right? The size of the tuple needs to be the same for input range and output range. Right. And then you pass path. And you know actually that paths are a tuple of Bezier curves.
Yep.
And here all these Bezier curves needs to be equal in size, right? They need to be a tuple also of the same size. And so to have like the nested tuple size thing, and you know you need to do it with generics because the size can be dynamic for both input range, output range, and the size, I still didn't get it to work. I think there is a way, it's just I'm not advanced enough, but then it gets pretty tricky. So still some use cases for which this option is very difficult, but then also some, I enabled the option and it really made my code better in some places. Because then to fix the error, I had to think about the code and it really made it better actually. And it also enabled me to see some weaknesses in some part of the code. So sometimes can be an improvement, sometimes can be very challenging, and sometimes maybe too difficult to move a legacy code base to this new option. But yeah.
Absolutely. I would definitely enable it for a new project.
Yes, exactly. That's the way to go. Yeah.
I mean, it's pretty common error that you do not handle undefined as a case. And this can help you fix a lot of bugs that lead to real world crashes.
Yeah.
Today.
It almost makes you want to be able to enable the rules only for some like folders or subfolders of your project. Is that something you can do in TypeScript? I don't think so.
So there's like this TypeScript references thing which divides your project into several subfolders, and then like you can build them dynamically and still import them otherwise, and you have multiple TS config files. And I did it, but would not recommend it so much, because then like the automatic import in VS Code seems to break for some reason, unfortunately.
Mm. Because that would be nice, right? If you could add this option incrementally, say, oh, I'm writing these new components, I want this rule to be enabled, but then I have this huge legacy component. There is no chance. I don't know. But yeah.
Yeah. For, I mean, there will always be new code written. And if this is being enabled, we can more and more of the code that we write and that is on GitHub will use these options and be more strict than ever, more bug-free than ever. Looking forward to that.
Cool.